All right, welcome in everyone to the three-digit World Cup live qualifier results and a round of 16 map pool showcase. I am happy to finally be here with some results. We're also going to be getting the live reaction to both results and the round of 16 map pool from one Mr. Chillier Pear, who has joined me here for the showcase. How's it going, Chillier?
How's it going? I guess I am officially roped into the map pool now. Excited. I'm excited to see the results for this year. A lot of big, different teams that have been put together, which makes for some interesting results chances.
Yeah. Definitely some surprising results this year. That's for sure. There are some big surprises this year. I think a lot of people will have a really interesting time with some of these qualifier results. So... yeah, without any further ado, I think we should just get into it. Let's start from the bottom up to the top, as per usual, with any results stream. All right, number 25 this year, unfortunately, is Turkey. One of our four-player rosters who really just did not have all that good a time on any of the maps in this pool.
Very unfortunate when you see Turkey. I think, you know, they show up for, OWC most years as well. And, you know, they kind of barely inch through qualifiers sometimes there. And unfortunately, I think they kind of lose that top tier level of player that they have there versus, you know, what they're able to put up at this tournament. Most notably, they didn't even have a team for this last year. So, you know, good on them for being able to put up a roster and come out play qualifiers this year at the very least.
So unfortunately we're not able to pass up. At least they did get a team around this year.
Yeah.
Keep this a little shorter than the tier list from last week. Now we move on to Estonia as the next team. Seed number 24. Another team who I believe did not exist last year, given the last year's placing number 64. Another four-member roster also, and kind of the same story. They did have a couple good scores on Nomad 2, Hard Rock 2, and Deep 1, but not nearly able to get in where they needed to.
Yep, very unfortunate. Again, you know, you'll see a lot of these unqualifying teams or unfortunate teams that missed that 16th place cutoff here that really just didn't have an outstanding map performance on anything, you know, with a, you know, maybe the exception of a couple of teams, and that's going to be the trend through a lot of these.
So good luck to them next year. Hopefully they can get a member or two more next year, and that can help make the difference for them for qualifying. But for now, we say goodbye to Estonia. We are also going to say goodbye to Norway. Our first full roster in the qualifier results here. And one that I'm personally a little surprised they did not make it in. I think we had Norway kind of on the border between qualifying and not qualifying, so to see the 23rd is a little bit surprising. Number 3 on Hard Rock 1 and still not qualifying really goes to show how important it is to have that consistency in qualifiers overall.
Very much so, and it really does reflect on the inconsistencies between the picks here. I think, you know, when you look at the style of map that Hard Rock 1 was very basic, besides, you know, maybe those couple wiggle streams there. Nomad 1, maybe the streams just a little bit too much, maybe the BPM a little bit too much, but generally you see some correlation between, you know, maybe that Nomad 1, Hard Rock 1, and DT 1 in some cases, and, you know, they just weren't, they were unfortunately not able to pull that out this year, and, you know, a country that normally has players like Yokespie and GN playing around the OWC range, unfortunately running without them means that their hidden scores were not super stellar this year, unfortunately.
No, the last place score on both hidden maps, definitely not what you want. And that ultimately is a big part of the reason why they are not going to be qualifying here, with the way that qualifiers was using, I believe, Z scores. Super low scores actually impact you pretty heavily, similar to golf. So... unfortunate there for Norway, and hopefully they can have a better showing next year. We'll say goodbye to one of their neighbors. Actually, we're gonna say goodbye to Denmark. Nearly identical flag and nearly identical placement for Denmark here, also down at number 22. Not gonna be seeing them in the bracket stage this year. A couple of okay scores on things like Nomad 3, Hidden 1, and Double Time 1, but overall near the bottom on a lot of maps, and that does make it pretty hard to qualify in.
Again, it's a very similar situation to Norway prior, just a little bit of a difference. Didn't really have a standout performance on any map, but just slightly better across the board.
Okay, let's keep moving on to now Israel, the number 21 seed. A four-player roster getting seed number 21 is not all that bad, right? With the four players, they still managed to beat out four teams in the qualifiers. And managed to take seed number 14 and 17 in the Hard Rock and Double Time pools, respectively. But the Nomad and Hidden really dragging their overall score down. You can see exactly where the focus is. You know, the Nomad won number 10 placement, and then really solid scores on DT and Hard Rock really point to this team having a lot of solid mechanics, but not being able to kind of transition that into some of the other skills that make their way into that pool.
Yep, well played by them on a couple of maps again. Number 15 on DT2, number 10 on Nomad 1, number 10 on Hard Rock 2. Decent on a couple of maps here. Just looking, again, at those standout performances. Not quite showing up yet. We'll welcome them back next year.
And now for number 20 is going to be Argentina. Another four-player roster. Definitely a roster I think a lot of us were expecting, unfortunately, not to qualify, and they do find their way number 20. Players. Very similar story as before. You can see a couple of scores now above that number 16 range from Argentina, but not the average score that's needed to qualify in.
Yeah, a little bit dangerous for them this year. Went downhill a bit, four-player roster compared to the full six-player roster they were able to put up last year, barely missing that top 16th place. And, you know, they went down a little bit, and I think that's as a result of not having as much versatility as previous years.
And not having Zidane in particular, really really making this team struggle. And I think that definitely puts them into the realm of not qualifying. Look to them next year. Hopefully they can get their full roster back next year. And next up in this list of qualifying teams is, I think, a very big surprise for a lot of people, myself included. Canada is not qualifying this year for 3WC. Vesprit, Curtis Lane, sorry, Vinopoly, and Yip. Seed number 19 here. The Nomad pool in particular really bringing the overall placement down for Canada. Number 21, 23 on Nomad 1 and 3. And number 18 on Nomad 2. Really not helping the case for qualifications for Canada.
I mean, how else do you describe this other than a complete tragedy? 11th place seeded last year, dropped 8 seeds, and I guess this really just does speak to testament of, you know, how competitive qualifiers were this year. Only a single map, Hard Rock 2, in 9th place. Every single other map outside of the top 10 best scores on them. Very particularly, again, Nomad 3, Nomad 1 outside of the top 20 on those. So really, I think this was just an underperformance from Canada on all accounts. You take a look at this roster, and there are very skilled players here, but it really comes down to consistency day of between two trials, and I guess, you know, that was not the day for them.
Yeah, and it's also really surprising because you always expect Canada to overperform, right, in the World Cup tournaments. They always have really good mental, generally speaking. You always see them kind of take their performance up a little bit of a notch compared to what you might expect based on just how the players themselves tend to perform. And we even overall in the show, in the tier list, expected this team to be top 8 maybe, or to at least contest top 8. So that is a very surprising qualifier result from them. And hopefully they do manage to rally back next year for the next iteration of 3WC Canada, obviously in 4WC and OWC, with really fantastic performances. So very unfortunate not to see them qualify. All right, I think we've said enough about Canada. Move on to the next couple of teams just barely not making the cut. Again, top 16 is what is required to qualify in to the three-digit World Cup this year, and Countryless East gonna just barely not be making the cut at seed number 18 here. Sigi, Big Z, Demonical, Saiku, and Tebby. Again, you can kind of point to Nomad 1, seed number 23 on that map, but more importantly, the Hidden pool where they were overall seed 19. Monochrome Princess and Lorelei really giving them just a bit too much trouble, I think, as every other pool they did manage to fit within the top 16 there.
Yeah, unfortunate for Country List East. And again, you know, another roster, I think that most people would take a look at this and you see a lot of star players here, but, you know, slightly better than Canada, had that ninth place on Nomad 4 and fairly impressive to get number 8 on DT1. You know, I think a lot of people were talking about how well countries were performing on that DT1 due to how comfortable it was. You know, you saw the feedback in the map pool. Map pool feedback channel, and you know, to be able to put up a couple of those is pretty solid, especially for a country list team, which is, you know, a little bit less coordinated maybe on some cases than you would think from a country team. So good for them to come out this year. Of course, the first year we have three country list teams split up, it makes it a little more competitive for them.
It definitely does. And I think big oof for some of the countryless teams. Speaking of how competitive it was, number 17 is countryless Central, which is just kind of a slap in the face to both of these countryless teams. Both of them quite literally the two teams just outside qualifications. As countryless Central going to be seed number 17, not quite making it in. Again, you can point to the Nomad, and this time around, some of the Hard Rock pool, some of the Hidden pool as to why this team didn't qualify. And it's really unfortunate to see a team that is this good on DT and speed, seed 5 overall on DT, not make it into the tournament. You lose a lot of really strong players with this team. Same for Countryless East in Canada, of course. But, really standout performance on the DT pool for this team.
Yeah, very, very well done for them. Again, I think, you know, and I'll say it again at the expense of sounding like a broken record, but all of these teams that just barely missed the top 16 spots, you'll see the shift happen very slowly as we start to move up, you know, top 16, top 12, top 8, top 5, where you'll see more and more of those single-digit placements across more maps, yeah. And that's what makes the difference. Again, you mentioned the golf seeding, the Z-scores, where, you know, the bad performances really do kill you. So stuff like Nomad 2 really does hurt.
I mean, that is... There are 25 teams, right? That is bottom score on Nomad 2, and that type of stuff is... Like, yeah, it's killer. Killer. When, so it is... A little unfortunate that that happens for Country Central, but that is the way the cookie crumbles for them. And now, from here on, we're just looking at the bracket. Every single other team who played did qualify, so commiserations to those 9 teams who did not make it in. And good luck to them next year in reforming their rosters and making it into the bracket stage. Well, let's start to take a look at some of the matchups that we might have here. We're going to start with seed number 16, the Netherlands, qualifying in as the very last seed, just sneaking their way in there.
Hey, good for them this year. Netherlands, again, another one of those teams, I think, that didn't have a roster last year, wasn't able to put something together for this tournament. So very, very impressive their first time showing up here that they were able to put up a qualifying team. Very notably, third place on Nomad 2. That map, I think, left a lot of countries maybe a little worse for wear, given the spiked space pattern, you know, towards the middle of that map and towards the ending. Very well played on the double time pool as well, and fairly respectable Hard Rock. Really only fell short on the more technical skill sets, the Nomad 3, the Nomad 4, fairly tech oriented Hidden 1, but looked good across the board.
You were talking about single-digit placements on more maps earlier. The literal last team, there are 4 single-digit placements. And even though they had really tough times with, like you said, all the tactical maps, I mean, 21 and 23 are both bottom 5 scores on Nomad 3 and 4. The plethora of single-digit placements that they had kind of outweighs that and lets them just barely edge their way into the qualifying round. Oh, let's move on to the next one. We now have Poland in as seed number 15. This is the type of performance that I think you expect to see the year after Poland does really well, right? Poland is just one of those teams. They're going to do really super well one year, and then they will just coin flip whether they repeat it or not, right? They did have the number one performance on the Hard Rock pool overall, which is really, really incredible. But with the rest of the map pools here, they had relatively lower end performances considering the competition in the bracket stage.
Yeah, very much mid to lower tier on most of these. And, you know, again, we always joke about it. Poland is almost that wild card team. They'll come out every single year and they will either have the single best performance you have ever seen out of them in the entire tournament, or they will just not have a good day. And, you know, that sounds kind of very, you know, black or white with the description, but that really is Poland. It is just completely 50-50 on whether or not they show up on qualifiers day. Luckily, with the qualifiers this competitive, they were still able to qualify, but maybe in an inopportune position for themselves, and maybe a little bit of extra work to do in the bracket for them this year.
Definitely some extra work to do in the bracket. This bracket is going to shape up to be really, really competitive, I think, so good luck to Poland in the bracket stage. Hopefully they can make pretty good use of that hard rock, especially with the free mods and the free mod rule out in the tournament. So, yeah, let's keep on moving now up to seed number 14. Sweden in seed number 14. Psyka, Blue, Yagiko, Lightwine, Knots, and Killa in Team Sweden. Really solid performances in the hidden and hard rock pools. I think we kind of know what they're going to be banning for Team Sweden. Number 20 on Nomad 2, and then number 22 and 19 on the two DTs. But you know what? The rest of the pool, they had a really, really solid performance overall.
Yeah, this team definitely falls a little bit short on the speed, and you know there are definitely a couple of really good speed players on this roster. Unfortunately, I think Sweden running with a little bit of third player syndrome on a lot of those maps, maybe second or third on the 10.3, and then the stamina. But very solid aim team. I mean, you look at this roster, hidden hard rock aim shines right through this. The Nomad 3 as well, very impressive on the flow aim for the alt there, so they certainly have their strong points. And maybe they'll give a little bit more trouble to that first round team that they play against them. They might expect.
Gotta hope for it if you're rooting for Team Sweden. That's for sure. Mm-hmm. They certainly have their strengths to play around. They certainly have their weaknesses to play around. And especially in the early rounds where all you need to do is just win maps. You don't need to be dominant across everything. That can make the difference in some of these early pools. So good luck to them. Go ahead and on to Japan now. Number 13, Rollpan, Hyphen, Invoker, Konkon, Laplus, and Tichy is the roster for Japan.
You know, I think Japan this year was a team that was rated very highly. And I think it was very much based on a couple of star players that really, really needed to perform on a consistent basis. In my mind, I think a lot of eyes were very much on Rollpan and La Plus One. For those of you that don't know, that is Iger. I think a lot of eyes were on them. Invoker has been playing, if you keep up with Hippo Cup lately, has been absolutely sending it through the stages. Hyphen, very strong player, Con. Tichy, not seen quite as often. I'm not sure if that's a name change. I really wish I did, but again, good performances. Top 10 on Nomad and Hidden, fell fairly far short in Hard Rock and Double Time, especially on that Hard Rock one there. Consistency maybe notwithstanding for this team, but again, strong points showing through. I think they'll perform much better in the bracket stage than they did in qualifiers.
Yeah, I think one other thing to note with this team is that you do have, I think, Konkon a little bit spread thin right now, is currently in the grand finals of another tournament with a fairly large prize pool, and so maybe not be might not be quite as focused on the qualifying round for 3WC. To that point, I have seen Konkon Kinakon have a little bit of trouble with some map pools recently that I wouldn't really expect from them, so you may do with that information what you will, but it's definitely a team that was rated much higher than their expected seeding, or than the seeding here that they managed to get in qualifiers. I do expect them to do better in bracket stage than their overall qualifier seeding. Well, okay. Let's keep it moving on now to our top 12. These are above the cut for the teams that just barely qualified. We're going to start getting into some teams who have really strong overall performances and some of the teams that you might be expecting to see really high up in the bracket stage. First one is going to be Hong Kong in seed number 12. Dragbit 3, F2X, Hibiki, MCY4, Nazar, also known as Denier Nazar or CLP, and RLSC.
This is a Hong Kong team that I think a lot of people expected to come out and perform this year. And, I think they came relatively close to where, you know, a lot of people would have expected them. They did not qualify last year. They 22nd place. You can see it up on your screens. Yep. To 12th this year is a massive improvement. And I would say based on a massive improvement in overall roster this year, they were missing a lot of heavy hitters in the 2021 iteration of this. So the fact that they were able to recover a little bit, they've brought back some people. They have a couple new faces, mixed in with the returnings. And, you know, I think they kind of settled into a comfortable spot for themselves. Again, I really think, you know, these, you know, 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th places are definitely going to perform better than people give them credit for. Fourth place on Hard Rock, very strong for them. This is one of those teams that just performed better across the board. They had, you know, that decent, really, really good performance on Hard Rock. No super stellar performance on any map in particular. You know, top five on Hard Rock 1, which is a competitive map. But again, just better across the board. Very versatile team.
Yep, I agree pretty much completely here. And that's the whole reason why this team was rated so highly initially, right? Is for that versatility. You just have a lot of different skill sets covered. I think the main thing that we on the tier list desk were thinking might not be covered is some of the sort of raw speed and stamina, but they very clearly are completely fine there. This is a team to watch out for, that's for sure. Definitely the potential as Denier Nezar gets back into the swing of things to really upset a few higher seeded teams as well.
Yeah, that's a little scary. Denier is frightening.
Denier's back, by the way.
Denier's back, by the way.
Yeah, good luck to Hong Kong. I hope we can see some kind of spicy upsets. I think it would be really interesting to see Hong Kong go for.
Yeah.
Next up is South Korea. In seed number 11 is Doomsday Fanboy, Spectre, Gusrua, Payne, Tofanim, and worst HR player on the South Korean roster. Extremely good Nomad pool placement. Top 10 on all Nomads and top 5 on 2 Nomads is something really, really spectacular. And it points to, I think, the breadth of skill sets that this team has. Right, being able to perform that well on all of the Nomads is not something that you often see from a team, because Nomad is a bunch of different skill sets thrown into the same mod category. So I think it's very telling on the overall consistency for this roster.
Yeah, great to see the versatility again show up through some of these teams here. A decent amount of trouble on the Hard Rock pool, almost near the bottom for that. But again, you know, if you put together a team that can play almost every skill sets, you come into a match, you double ban the two Hard Rock maps that you don't want to deal with, and you're pretty solid on the rest of the pool. And, you know, then the team that you're playing against, who performs well on Hard Rock, maybe doesn't have as much of a shot as they initially thought against you. And, you know, again, that's the little nuances that you kind of see from teams like this. Again, you know, you mentioned top 10 on DT, top 8 actually technically if you count that 8th spot there. And again, that Nomad performance is just a force to be reckoned with. Absolutely insane from them.
Yeah, really, really solid overall performance from Korea. Hopefully they can play around that hard rock weakness, pan out some hard rocks, and stick Doomsday Fanboy on the hard rock during the free mods. And I think that's a pretty solid strategy for them. Move on to perhaps the most surprising seeding in the qualifiers now. Even more surprising than Canada not qualifying is Brazil qualifying in 10th place.
Mm-hmm.
This is a team that was pretty much universally expected to at least contest for the win, if not just take the tournament. But they got 10th in quals, so lol.
I almost liken this to, I think, all right, when we look at a team like Canada, who came out this year, played qualifiers, didn't have the best day across the board. Yeah. Brazil is one of those teams, they didn't have their best day on a lot of maps, but they did have their shining moments. And I think those shining moments across the board, very namely, Hard Rock 2. That is what most teams would argue one of the hardest maps in the pool, and they were able to put up number one on that map fairly confidently here. you know, they've got good performances on the Nomad 3 and 4. Hidden Pool, absolutely fantastic from them. And, you know, Double Time, a little worse for wear on the DT1. Maybe not that 10.3 aim team that you're looking at. But even at that, I mean, you've got Corian Maluko, you've got Mistia, you've got Nissan, you've got plenty, you know, Luis, you've got plenty of people that can play that 10.3 aim pick on the DT there. So, again, I think that's just a blunder in performance from them. This is a team that is far below where they should be.
Yeah, exactly. And apparently Nissan just didn't play qualifiers. This is just an MREC oversleeping type of situation again, I guess. I don't know. So their best player just didn't play qualifiers. So yeah.
That explains a lot.
That explains a lot. Explains the number 23 on DC1, that's for sure. At the very least. So yeah, I think... I think this team will do a lot better than 10th place, and I think it's going to be very interesting to see who they get matched up against. Because
yeah, I'm sorry for 7th seed.
Yeah, I'm also sorry for 7th seed. I can see here who 7th seed is. I am sorry for them.
I cannot, and I'm already sorry.
Yeah, let's take a look at the middle of the pack, shall we? We're getting right into the middle of things with seed number 9 now is the Russian Federation, Din Gamer 228666. Miniwa, Pekka Russian, Temkina, and Tester Pivka. This team did extremely well on Nomad and extremely well on Hard Rock, and then had a very tough time of both the Hidden and Double Time pool.
This Russia roster does not scream Hidden whatsoever. And no. I feel like Russia never does scream Hidden. I think that's generally where they fall short in OWC and 3WC and 4WC. You know, Double Time for this roster, not performing well on Double Time, is quite surprising for them. You know, I think you see players like Din and Gamer and Pekka Russian, and you really expect a good DT performance out of them. So the fact that they were not able to put up, you know, at least top 8 across that DT pool is slightly concerning for them. And again, and Russia's another one of those teams that kind of has the stereotype, oh, Russia kind of hits that semifinals wall every single year in the tournaments that they play. And I think this was one of those years where maybe some people had some hope for Russia that they'd be able to push that semifinals wall. And unfortunately, after the qualifiers performance, maybe rethinking that a little bit. Really good Hard Rock performance, very solid on the Nomad, but again, the all-round performance just isn't quite there for them yet. Losing on Hidden and Double Time like that is very much concerning for a wide variety of skill sets.
Yeah, one thing that you can take away is that the DT1 performance was way worse than the DT2 performance, and so maybe mm-hmm. Russia can still, you know, manage to contest some of the overall speed picks between themselves and seed number 8. But that's a matchup that we can actually talk about right now, because we are about to go into seed number 8, which is Indonesia. This is
top 8
for Indonesia, outpacing the tier list suggestions for Indonesia. Puma, Krez, Delon, Dito, Arexes, and that noob guy with honestly, very solid performances across the board. Very good Nomad performance. Very, very good Hidden performance. Number 2 and number 5 on those two maps. Not the best Hard Rock performance. And honestly, pretty similar DT performance overall to Team Russia as well.
Yeah, good for them. Honestly, Hidden and Nomad. Russia, ban Hidden right now. Do it immediately. ban both of them. You will not win them. Indonesia, very impressive Hidden lineup here. Rexes, Fuma, Krez, that is scary. That is dangerous. That will carry them through very late stage because they have very high skill cap on those players as well. Across the board, a good roster this year for Indonesia. Again, a team that didn't come out last year really came and strutted their stuff. You know, you see Indonesia come out in OWC, and, you know, quite a few of these players making an appearance on the OWC roster as well, and a very, you know, decently performing team. You know, off of maybe a slightly disappointing OWC year for them, I think they're going to have a very good run in this tournament and, you know, maybe use that as a little bit of a slingshot for this upcoming iteration.
Yeah, I hope they manage to live up to the hype from OWC. That's all I have to say for
100%.
Yeah. I hope they manage to live up to that hype in 3WC, because this is a very good roster and I think they have some very clear strong points that they can use and abuse against a wide variety of teams.
Very good roster.
Yeah, let's keep on moving now to the unlucky team who drew Brazil in round of 16 It is Team China, Genshin Phobia, Crystal, I'm a Burger Fox, Lolo233, or Milk Tea, My Angel Anzu, and Shizaki Kanon. And Chillier, I don't know about you, but when I see this China roster on early stage up against Brazil's roster on early stage, I am so excited for how that matchup is going to go. Because this is like, this roster right here is one that if I'm any team on early stage, I just don't want to play against.
Here's where I'm a little bit concerned about this matchup. Brazil and China are top four teams, I think, both of them.
Yeah.
And they're about to face off in round of 16. Mm-hmm. So I hope everyone enjoys the, you know, finals matchup on the round of 16, 6.5 star map pool. Yes. I mean, I don't know what to say. I mean, they got... China was one of those teams...
Oh, my lord.
They placed well in basically everything. They just didn't have a stellar performance in any particular mod pool, and that was their downfall to 7th seed this year. Despite them performing exceedingly well compared to last year, 12th to 7th seed, you know, good all around, just didn't have the star player today, despite the fact that they are running a roster that would absolutely disintegrate a lot of teams.
Yeah. I mean, this is, you kind of said it, this is a finals matchup on a round of 16 pool, as the, combined tier list has Brazil contesting top one and China contesting top three alongside France. So these are two teams that were expected to get basically top three out of the tournament, and they are facing off in round of 16. So have fun with that
goodness.
One. Yeah,
honestly.
I'm excited for this matchup. I am very excited for this matchup. Yeah, I'm really excited for this one. Let's keep it moving. We could talk about this matchup all day long, but I think we should save that for when the match actually happens.
Yeah.
So let's go on to seed number six now. Top six for these teams now. It is the United Kingdom in seed number six. Kingling, Doomsday, Jemzy, Mahmood, Plasma, and Rinnu. This team had a pop-off performance, I think. A lot of people, I think, expected the UK to do a lot worse. Three of us had the UK as just qualifies, doesn't get top eight. And they very much proved us wrong. This is a really solid performance on the Nomad and Hidden Pool specifically. And with, of course, Hard Rock 1 and DT 1, the just raw aim for this team is really, really solid.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of those rosters, again, I think the UK is, and we talked about it, and, you know, I'm kind of relating to OWC because a lot of these players are very similar to OWC rosters for a lot of these countries, but, you know, the UK is one of those teams that we talked about very heavily as being in almost that, you know, the rebuilding 2 or 3 years here where country takes a little bit of a hit to their upper skill cap and they have to kind of take some time to have those lower level players start to push their way up. And the United Kingdom, despite running with, you know, some older players in here. I mean, you've got, you know, Kingling is coming back. Doomsday has been around for longer than most people have been alive playing this game. Jemzy, fantastic aim player, returning again. You know, Mahmood and Plasma, I believe, are new additions to the team from last year. They are, yes. And, you know, Rinnu coming back as that aim player again. Very good for them. This is a good hidden team. This is a strong hidden team. Doomsday kind of fronting that quite a bit for them. Yeah. Strong Nomad 1, 3, and 4 as well. So the aim in all aspects, flow aim, snap aim, big jumps, this is the team that you watch out for on aim. Even double time 1, the stark difference in performance from 7th to 21st on DT2,
yeah, I mean,
it speaks volumes.
I mean, this team, we talk about, you know, pronounced strengths and weaknesses for some of these teams. It doesn't get much more pronounced than this. This is a team that bans precision and speed and streams, and it picks everything else. So have fun with that. It doesn't ban precision free mod. Definitely does not ban precision free mod. But it's very obvious the pick ban strategy for this team, just looking at the qualifier results. And I think it'll make for straightforward matchups that could maybe provide some interesting results, especially with the depth of skill that you see here for this team. They are top five on 5 maps.
Yeah, that's good.
They're top five on both Hiddens and 3 Nomads. They got top 3 on 3 Nomads. That's really good.
I mean, I don't know what to say. I mean, their worst placement was Hard Rock, and that's with King Ling on the roster, and you know he's going to perform better during a match. So, you know, you've got that performance on your back. So even your worst mod pool overall, you still have strong players. And you got Rinnu, too. Very strong aim player.
Yeah. All right. Let's see how the rest of the qualifiers shake out now. I think we've said enough about the United Kingdom. We can go on to number five. Is Australia in number five? Jordan the Bear, Dumi and Numi, Jordan LR7, Straub, and Vivace. This team is almost the best DT team in the tournament. I have an idea of who the best DT team in the tournament actually is, but this one is second best. And they have a couple of other really good placements in Hard Rock 2 and Nomad 1. I'm going to be interested to see how well this team can scale their other picks into the late stage. They have a very good bracket set up for them being seed number five, though. Very, very good bracket for Australia.
Yeah, this is going to be a strong performance from Australia this year. I think Australia does get a little bit of rough bracket RNG every single year in these big tournaments. You see Australia come out, and I think a lot of people talk about, you know, all the time, they don't give Australia enough credit. They come out every single year, and they're, you know, oh, Australia underperformed this, and that. Wah. Yeah, their brackets are really hard every single year in most big tournaments. So Australia getting a good bracket placement and having quite a strong roster this year is most certainly going to benefit them in more ways than one. Again, that double time performance is stellar. The Nomad 1 performance is very good for them. This is a team that you look at it is very mechanics oriented. This is a strong aim stream team right here. Not a whole lot of technical skill sets going for them. They're going to have to learn how to deal with that against some of the higher seeded teams here that have some more versatility in that range. But for the time being, where mechanics does matter very much, you know, round of 16, quarters, semis, that is going to be good for them.
Yeah, and I think the big question for Australia, of course, is how well they can, you know, practice some of the other picks in these pools, or how well they can transition into the larger pools. For example, the addition of Nomad 5 DT3 in the very first pool, I think, is going to be very good for Australia, right? Like, there are differences between these qualifier pools and what the bracket stage actually looks like. I think some of those changes favor Australia. I think some of them aren't quite as good for Australia, but well, I think this is obviously a team to watch, right? Top five out of qualifiers and with some very interesting placements on some of the qualifier maps to boot. Oh, good luck to them. Yeah. They also have a matchup in the quarterfinals, assuming they win their round of 16 match. They have a matchup in the quarterfinals against our number four seeded team. Countryless West is number four.
Sheesh.
This is a good team, guys. This is a very good team. Ramon 2, who I will herefore refer to as Hammy TR. Wolfie, Donnet, Rebo, Riot, and Unexpected. This team had some insane performances on the modded categories. DT in particular, number 4 and number 1 on those two maps, but number 2 and 3 on Hard Rock 1 and Hidden 2, respectively.
Number 1, DT2, that is cracked. That map is so breakable and over and under aim, miss aim, whatever the hell you want to do on that map type map right there. And the fact that they were able to put out 3 FCs on that is insane. Hard Rock 1, probably, again, one of the most frustrating maps in this pool. Those wiggle streams, the little nuances that you can miss on, being able to put up top 2 on that is crazy from them. Hard Rock 2, worse for wear again, mentioned one of the harder maps in the pool. Good DT. Hidden 2, the AR8 reading for this team, maybe a little surprising. You know, I don't think you take a look at this roster and instantly think AR8 hidden, but they certainly proved it to us running with a strong roster this year. And I guess that happens when you split up Countryless into 3 different teams this year. You're bound to have one team that performs, you know, at least somewhat to expectations. Countryless was 6th last year as a combined effort, and Countryless West by themselves just surpassed that into 4th this year. So exceedingly well done from them.
Yeah. This is, again, a team. We're getting to the point where you can't really talk about pronounced strengths and differences in it, or strengths and weaknesses in a team, right? Like, yeah, you can point out, oh, they were top four on four maps, but like their worst placement on any map is 13th, right? Like, they don't really have any maps that they're actually all that bad at. I think if anything, you just point to like inconsistency on some things, or for example, nerves going into slider maps, given the performance that they had on both Hard Rock 2 and Nomad 4, right? But overall, the performance for this team is really, really solid, and I expect to see them go far. This is a team that, if you look at a lot of the names on it, definitely has the skill cap to still do well later on into a tournament like 3WC, where you don't get to quite the same star rating or overall pool difficulty as you would in, for example, international tournaments or in the OS World Cup, right? So I think this team has a lot going for them. Be very interesting.
Very much so.
All right, I have some prep for the next one. So, when we did the tier list for OWC, I completely cursed both Chile and Indonesia out of any chance at performing well by building too much hype around them. And so this year with the 3WC tier list stream, I put Germany low on purpose so that they would score high. You're welcome, KHC. They're seed three in this tournament out of qualifiers. Number three on the DT pool. Number one on the Nomad pool. Number one, two, and four on Nomad 2, 3, and 4. Very, very solid overall performance for Team Germany, as expected of the two-time number two OWC team.
This roster is frightening. This is the type of roster that comes out here, and, you know, Germany for OWC the past 2 years has been super scary and has only been taken down by the United States, who has been on absolute tear the past few years at that rank range. And Germany has decided to bring some of their star OWC players down to the three-digit rank range, where, you know, some teams like the United States and, you know, maybe Australia even don't have players like MREC and I'm a Fancy Lad and people that absolutely smash map pools with FCs into 8-star ranges. You've got Kriller, you've got Shark, KHC, Rising, Onroys, Willy, basically an entire roster of 6 people that can play early stage, late stage, consistency, technical skill sets, mechanical skill sets, top seed the entire Nomad pool because it's easy for them type team. This is going to be a good team this year, to say the very least.
Yeah. Good team, to say the least, I think, is definitely it. Yeah, I am really excited to see how this does, and I think they are going to have a really solid overall performance this year. I think, if anything, you can point to Hard Rock and maybe Nomad 1 as the places where you can actually abuse this team. But that's a very small set of weaknesses compared to top 10 on literally everything else, top 5 on 5 out of 10 maps as well for this team.
Oh, man. Looking forward to this team this year. Very, very unironically. You know, not just because they're a third seed. This team will go very far this year.
All right. Seed number two, and by default, you'll also know who seed number one is if you've been paying attention so far. Seed number two is France. Last year they were number 14 out of the tournament. This year, back with a vengeance. It is Musty, Besta, Ikoro, Hifkill, Thunder, and Vroom. That is a scary, scary roster.
This is a France roster that... Okay. Let me start off for those of you who maybe don't know too much about kind of the history of France. France is one of those countries where they will put up a roster of what seems to be a very, very solid powerhouse roster. And they have a history of having that powerhouse roster and very, very much underperforming to what a lot of people expect them to. this roster this year is going to make a full turnaround of that. This is not only a strong roster on paper, they're versatile in their skill sets. They are good at basically everything you throw at them. They can put together a 2-3 person roster on, and it speaks very loudly through their performance in the top six placements of all four categories of map here. Third place in Nomad, second place in Hidden. They took number one on Hidden 2, number one on Hard Rock 1. And, you know, their only performance out of the top eight was Hard Rock 2. And that is it. And that probably doesn't mean anything because they got number one on Hard Rock 1. So France wins the tournament when?
Well, as soon as they get through either Brazil or China in quarterfinals. Just a reminder that those two are seed 7 and seed 10. So no matter who wins that matchup, France has to face one of them, right? So just a reminder on the combined tier list we made before the start of the tournament, that Brazil, China, and France were our combined top three teams. So you're gonna get China versus Brazil in round of 16, and then France versus the winner of that, probably France versus the winner of that in quarterfinals. Apologies, of course, to Poland, who actually has to face off against France in the round of 16. But I kind of expect France to win that matchup. This team that is just super, super dominant. Any of these early stage pools just has ridiculously good players all across the board.
Yeah, bracket RNG is bad. I don't like bracket RNG. That is weird.
Yeah, yeah, it's a little it's a little bit of a stacked bracket, gotta say.
Yeah, yep.
The good news is if they make it through those, though, they actually they don't get an easy bracket at all, because they would face Germany afterwards. And then if they manage to make it all the way into the winners' finals, assuming no seeding upsets, they would be facing off against the first seed in the tournament, the United States.
Hello.
Yeah, I got a lot of pushback for saying that the USA was actually really good this year. But hey, guys, I think the USA
that.
Is
I
actually
like
really
that.
Good this year.
I'm
pretty sure the USA is actually a good team this year. Number one on both the hidden and a double time pools. Number five on the Hard Rock pool, and yeah, not the best performance on Nomad, but the only map they were below top 10 on was Nomad 4. This is a very good team. This is a very well-rounded team, and this is a team that will scale into the later rounds also.
I will make this as objective as possible as to not give significant bias as the captain of this team. This United States roster is quite literally a 180 from last year. There are 0 out of 6 players that remained from last year's team into this year. And knowing that, it is very understandable in a tier list or in any prediction that a lot of people would rate the US lower than, you know, what I think is generally expected of a United States team. Despite being the country who has won the World Cup for the past few years, despite being, I believe, the second place team or third place team, sorry, from last year, you know, completely different roster, new faces to this high level 3-digit tournament scene, and it's very understandable that their rating may not have been that high. But being on the inside and knowing how this team was formulated and seeing the results from, you know, tryouts and all that different type of thing, it was very evident that there is, you know, kind of something special between a brand new 6-player roster this year. So, you know, notwithstanding a very solid performance on the back of it and a hell of a lot of competitive teams, this year is going to make this bracket stage absolutely insane.
Yeah, couldn't really agree more. I think that this USA team is probably one of the best that we will have seen recently. USA last year got third, by the way, so I say that with the knowledge that USA was actually also very good last year, and I just think that they are going to be better this year instead. I think USA is going to have a pretty good time with this bracket. I think their bracket overall is way easier than that of second or third place to boot. So congratulations to the USA for having a really, really solid overall placement in the qualifiers and very likely being able to take good advantage of that as well.
Thank you, teammates. Appreciate you.
Yeah. All right. That is going to do it for the qualifier results stream. We are going to swap over to the showcase here shortly. I have a need to take care of a couple of things around the house, namely walking my dog because it's her bedtime, and if she does not get a walk, I will not live it down. So I'm going to take care of that, and then we'll be on to the round of 16 map pool showcase. So yeah, congratulations to all the teams that managed to qualify in. We will be back in probably about 10 minutes with the qualifier map pool showcase. Don't go anywhere.
Shit, I'll go to the と神の幻想に汚染された僕らの脳寂しがりやまた一人助けに来てこんな僕でも愛してよ I'm lonely so tonight 愛せたって I'm lonely so tonight 満たせたいそれだけの仕方がない Nah
何もいらない。歩くたび息が詰まった。初めてバイトを逃げ出した。音楽も生活ももうどうでもよかった。ただ気に食わないものばかりが増えた。8月号月明かり自転車で飛んで東伏見の高架橋小平富士見通りと商店街。夜風が穴をくすぐった。この胸の痛みは気のせいだ。分かってた、分かったふりをした。最低だ、最低だ、僕の全部最低だ。君を形に残したかった。思い出になってしてるもんか。最低だ、最低だ、気持ちよくて仕方がないわ。最低だってこの歌詞自体が。笑うほど喉が渇いた。初めて心を売り出した。狂心もプライドももうどうでもよかった。気に食わない奴にも頭を下げた。8月某あの頃の景色をまたいだ。ストックホルムのロテンション切る長村スタンは石畳。君だけを胸にしまった。この空の青さも気のせいだ。笑った顔のまま。最低だ、傲慢だ、君もみんな貪欲だ。ドラマチックな歌も愛もさ、馬鹿らしくて仕方がないわ。知っていた、知っていた、君の人生君のものだ。最低だっていくら叫ぼうが。そうだ、きっとそうだ、あの世ではロックンロールが流れてるんだ。賛美歌とか流行らない様がいないんだから。罪も過ちも犯罪も自殺も戦争もマイノリティも全部知らない。そんなの欺瞞と同じ。耐えれば最低だ、最低だ、愛おしくて仕方がないわ。ドラマチックな夜で僕をいたみたい。最低だ、最低だ、言葉なんて冗長だ。君の人生は月明かりだ。ありがちだなんて言わせるもんか。最低だ、最低だ、笑われたって仕方がないわ。最低なんてこのだけの歌詞だ。人生27で死ねるならロックンロールは僕を救った。
You haven't seen any of the news so far regarding this. We did have some technical difficulties with some of the seedings for the teams. We're going to recap some of those technical difficulties as soon as we get everything sorted out on the back end. For now, hang tight. Thanks for your patience, and we'll be back soon TM with a couple changes to seeding and the roundups. Okay. All right. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the three-digit World Cup qualifier results stream and round of 16 map pool stream. The seeding errors that we had before that we were talking about have been fully corrected on the sheet. We do have some slightly different seedings going on now. It does not impact any of the teams who did not qualify, and does not impact most of the bracket. The significant changes, however, happen to the top 10 teams in the bracket. Go ahead and reveal the new seeding that we have here. This is a very different seeding. You can see France still is unfortunately getting either China or Brazil as their second round opponent. China and Brazil still facing off in the round of 16 in seeds 8 and 9. Some notable changes to the top four, the United States dropping down to seed number 4 rather than seed number 1, and everybody else in the top four shifting up by one. I believe it is also the United Kingdom moving up a bit in seeding to number 5. Australia moving down to number 6. I believe they were number 5 before. Russia moving down to number 10 from number 9. Indonesia moving up to number 7 from number 8. And that is all of the seeding changes that we have. These results will be put out onto the main sheet later on so that those with questions about any of the seeding can ask them, or so that you can see the full qualifier results once those are actually on the sheet. For now, with those seeding results in mind, and a revised bracket in mind, although honestly the changes to the bracket are not incredibly significant given how some of these teams are going to have to face off anyway with the old bracket, let's move into the map pool showcase now for quarterfinals. And joining me for the map pool showcase for quarterfinals is going to be Mr. Fiery Rage. How's it going, Fiery?
Hello, I just came in. What's going on, guys?
We just sorted out a couple of seeding issues, but I think we're good now. I think we're good with those now. Let's move on to now some other stuff here. Let's put that behind us, shall we? And get into some of the map pool showcase proper now. Let me go ahead and start it off with Nomad 1 here. One is, I think, one that some people will recognize from a... from fairly recently. Definitely a map that has seen some play in recent tournaments. I believe this was a qualifier Nomad 1 in America's Draft Showdown a little while ago. Now making a second appearance in recent memory here in 3-Digit World Cup. Definitely a Nomad 1. There's honestly, I don't think, a ton to say about this pick. It does jump consistency fairly well. The star rating for this 6.75 stars. Not super high, but not super low either. I think most teams will find this hard enough. Easy to miss on in just random parts during the PIs. But if your jump aim is really, really solid overall, you should find this a pretty simple test of consistency.
Some 205 BPM burst there as well throughout the map. So not just your generic raw aim consistency, there are a couple of bursts there. be manageable though. Other than that, yeah, you pretty much said everything I was going to say about this map. This is Nomod 1. Not really much you can say about a Nomod 1 besides look at these jumps. I hope you guys like aiming.
You guys like jumps. Yeah, I think this pool in general, from what I looked at of it, is relatively tame. I think this is a very safe pool with a lot of pretty straightforward picks that don't do a lot of super interesting things, but I think a lot of people will find the pool pretty good because of that. I don't think that there are going to be a lot of maps that draw a lot of ire from the players this week, just because of the fact that a lot of the maps are kind of what you expect from the slot in a pool. So while we wait for Nomod 1 to finish out, we can talk about some of the rest of the pool, like the format and that type of stuff.
Yeah, the format is essentially what you'd expect from most tournament map pools. You have 3 hard rocks, 3 hiddens, 4 double times, 3 free mods, and 6 no mods. We're getting right into it without the need for... Usually you'd see tournaments start with 5 no mods and maybe 2 per mod pool. But, yeah, we just get right into having the full-size map pool in round of 16.
Yeah. One other thing with this pool, I saw Nick mention it in chat earlier, but one thing to note is this is a little bit harder than was originally planned, so hopefully that'll help with general expectations of difficulty throughout the tournament. I think the tournament will probably scale a little bit slower than intended because of that, but that's probably fine to keep the skill floor up in this round and not make things too easy for some of the players. Given that it is 3-digit World Cup, you have a relatively narrow range of skill compared to a lot of other tournaments, which does make balancing the map pools around that a little bit challenging.
Yeah, that is your Nomod 1.
It's a Nomod
by 1. And large, by and large, what you would expect. Not too much to really say about that, but we're going to be getting into Nomod 2. Kind of a high BPM on this, but still relatively manageable. Not that much of an increase from quarterfinals. It is Grand Chariot by Xi. Xi, but I just want to pronounce it C for some reason.
I'm pretty sure it's actually pronounced Psy, like the K-pop dude. No cap, I'm pretty sure that's how it's pronounced. Like,
can't believe this guy made Gangnam Style. Anyway, yeah. 191 BPM streams on this one, relatively short length, almost, actually barely just missing 2 minutes on this one. But yeah, this is also another custom map for a different tournament in 2021, I believe. Somewhere around that age, the tournament scene. And yeah, it is combine Xi, the typical, or Psy, the typical stream-oriented piano music guy, and wow, you have this map, which is 1/4, and a lot of them.
Yep. Again, this is like very, very standard Nomod 2 style mapping. It's a custom map Nomod 2 for another tournament, so you know what it's going to be. Which is basically all streams and some flow aim here and there also, and, you know, sometimes it changes it up, and instead of doing streams, just does consecutive bursts. And yeah, before we get into the rest of the showcase, do want to just shout out this map pool showcase is brought to you by Malashevsky. This guy did a lot of replays. A lot of replays.
Yeah, he decided to just say, yeah, I have time, and then he just did this.
I'll do the pool, sure.
Yeah, I'll do the entire pool. Don't worry about it.
I'll get replays for every map you've pulled so far in a day. No problem, dude. Sure. But yeah, like I said at the start of this, a lot of the picks this week, I think, are extremely in line with what you would usually expect from your quote-unquote high-profile open rank tournaments, right? 3WC is pseudo open rank, higher skill floor, lower skill ceiling, but generally hitting the same types of expectations from the players. Yeah, I think a lot of the maps this weekend are going to really slot in pretty nicely with what players usually expect from a map pool in open rank international tournaments like this.
Yeah, you pretty much said it better than I can. A lot of these maps, there are a few oddballs here and there, but by and large, it's mostly your generic map pool. Nomad 3, here's the alt map for you. It's going to be Psyche. I hope I pronounced that right. I'm assuming
I
did. I
don't know.
Palette. This is a Suki Nathan map before he name changed back to Nathan.
This one has some interesting stuff going on. We can talk a little bit about this map. Obviously, the alt map in the Nomad pool being Nomad 3, another replay done by Malashevsky, Mr. Ristol. Error 9.4 CS4. Very long map. 4 minutes 53 seconds on this map. I could have sworn it was a little shorter. Maybe the length.
Drain time is slightly shorter than that, but it's still, by and large, 4 minutes 40 seconds.
Okay. So, yeah. Fairly long map. Long song. Good song, but still. This map kind of runs the gamut in terms of your typical alt skill sets. You have stuff like low BPM cut streams, you have a high spacing flow aim, you have high spacing snap aim, you have cut doubles, you have these cut triple streams, you have expanding streams, you have 1/6 and 1/3 in this map. It kind of does it all. I think the biggest thing that this map doesn't do is your sort of high caliber aim control type of patterns. You don't get the stuff like what you see in, you know, for example, Corsi's Open Grand Finals, right? That alt map from last year, or the OWC Grand Finals alt map from this previous year. You don't get the type of really, really wacky aim control patterns that you see there, but you do see a lot of other more structured type of stuff in this map.
Yeah, if you told me that this was a Nathan alt map, I would not second guess you at all. This looks pretty much what you would expect from those two terms combined together. Nathan's been doing quite a few alt maps for, I believe, some tournaments as well, but he's been relatively consistent at mapping these sort of alt-oriented snap aim picks. Have a lot of 1/6 bursts in them as well. Also, I'm pretty sure Malashevsky is sight reading because I don't know if he would. I don't think he would have gotten those hundreds otherwise if he wasn't sight reading. So, yeah.
He is definitely sight reading. There are a few funny sight read, like noticeable sight read mess ups that he has on some of these replays.
Yeah, I just do that, by the way. I too do that every day, actually. I just FC around the 16 pools, sight read.
I've talked the map to death already. We've talked about Ristol's replay already. Song's pretty good. I got this on my playlist.
Never been the biggest fan of Psyche, honestly.
This one's not a usual Psyche song, though. This is like Psyche venturing into J-Rock type of deal, right?
I guess I can see that, yeah. Got the little solo here, a lot of flow aim oriented patterns in this one. Still retaining most of the snap aim though.
Oh yep,
that was
another 50.
That was a good 50.
I think this is the, like, kind of most out there map in the pool, frankly speaking. There's not...
Well, there's a couple of them, I think, that are a bit more out there than this. One of them is in Gnomon Pool, as a matter of fact. It's not what you would really think of for its slot.
Well, yeah, but if you go back, like, before 2021, you would definitely find that type of map there, right?
Well, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's still kind of expected, right? Maybe not in OWC or, like, Corsace or probably Perennial this year either, but, yeah, definitely something that you can expect for that slot.
All right, now getting into the tech map, Gnomon 4. This is another custom map for a different tournament, Coffee Hispanic Tournament, as a matter of fact. Easy mode by Akira Complex.
The Facil difficulty for this one. A lot of slider aim in this. A bit of stream aim, too, in this map. I think this is a map, like, that you would have called, oh, this is just an aim map, like, in 2019 when everybody was trying to be hipster and say that slider aim maps weren't tech maps. But this is definitely a tech map, especially by modern standards. I think, obviously, with the return to, like, quote-unquote tradition of slider aim maps largely being considered tech, this definitely falls under the purview of that. But you do also have a lot of the sort of, like, 2019-2020 tech meta mixed in with this map. You've got a lot of really ridiculous flow aim. You've got a couple changes to 1/3 in this map as well. But by and large, slider aim.
Don't mess up on that slider.
Or this one.
That does... this one's easy to read. That first one was kind of... That one too, actually. But that one's not really that hard to break on. These are wacky sliders in general. Don't sight read this. Like that. Don't don't sight read that and then slider break on the slider tick there.
A really sad replay because he does not SS. Yeah. Little bit
well,
sad.
You just jinxed it for him, so.
Totally.
Of course he's not gonna SS when you do that.
I mean, like, I gotta get my rocks off somewhere during the stream, alright? Gotta jinx somebody somewhere.
Yeah, you're under, like, you are desperate for caster cursing now. You absolutely need it. You have been in withdrawal.
Like, I cursed Germany from the bottom bracket to top bracket by intentionally putting them low on the tier list. If I can do that, I can do anything. All right? Time. Satori de Pon.
Gnomon 5.
This is Gnomon 5, by the way.
Yeah, 235 BPM burst map. I believe this is also a custom map for a Gnomon 5 in a different tournament. Don't remember what tournament that was, but yeah, 2 minutes of 235 BPM bursts. It's a gore shit map. Whoever did this replay is a nerve control god.
Pretty sure this is also Ristol. Disco Marek. I think that's also Ristol, but I don't know.
Ristol shakes this much on speed?
I don't know. I don't think he does. That's also what I was thinking. Like, who shakes this much on speed? This is not Ristol.
Like, how do you hit that?
Yeah.
That's impressive.
This is indeed Bristol. Okay, huh.
That's crazy.
There we are. No more giant black background on the map stats, by the way.
Yeah, this is not really much else to say about this map. Hope you can burst.
Yep, hope you can burst 235. Also, hope you like listening to Gorshit if you're practicing this one. If you don't like listening to Gorshit, you may not be in for a good time. Does not get much more Gorshit than this song.
That's Nomad 5. Nomad 6, this is the one I was saying was kind of out there, especially compared to the Nomad 6s we've been seeing in tournaments recently. But as Dio said, I'm pretty sure I saw this as an Nomad 6 in pretty much, I think, four other tournaments at this point. This is a very popular map set. Like, yeah.
You know what it is already. You already know what it is. By the way, video on. Always video on for this one.
Yeah, not really that many people that are not familiar with this map set. But if you're not, pretty much, I would combine this as a tech alt hybrid in some fashion, as the BPM is low enough for it to still be somewhat alt oriented, but high enough to be more tech oriented at the same time.
Yeah, Moff's extra difficulty of this as well, combining the precision and low approach rate aspects at the same time with just really ridiculous flow aim, accel, decel, and like Doppler style streams in this map. Makes it really, really tricky to keep combo together and not just chain miss all over the place with this map.
This is a hard rock map.
It's actually an easy map. Hot take.
Everyone that plays this map should play it with the video, or else they get disqualified.
I agree. You're required to turn on local live stream whenever you play this map, just to prove you are playing it with the video.
Yeah, that does it for the Nomad pool. Beginning into the Hidden pool now, starting off with another relatively familiar map if you've played in Corsair's Open 2020. Here is the round of 16 Hidden 2. Well, Hidden 1 in this tournament, Rolling Girl.
Yeah, this is, I feel like a mostly forgotten hidden map from Corsair's Open. Hasn't really been used anywhere outside of it, but does the trick. Awkward aim. Not a lot to say about this. This is like the epitome of early stage Hidden 1. You don't have anything really crazy going on in this map. There's not anything super dense here because it's only 195 BPM AR 9.2. Couple streams here and there, kind of it. I don't know. I think this is like a little deceptively easy. It definitely feels more awkward when you're playing it than it does on stream. But I do think this is going to give way to far more awkward aim picks later on in the tournament.
is your, by and large, aim consistency in the hidden pool, 3 minutes long, at a comfortable BPM that pretty much everyone can play. Not too much to say about this one, other than it's much like every other aim map in its slot, with the one marker. There's a couple of unique patterns in this map, though, and that stream being one of them. I'd say a bit more awkward to hit that than compared to some of the awkward jumps that you'd see throughout the map.
Yeah, this is also a sight read replay. Okay. This was just about to wonder whether this was sight read or not, but yeah, it definitely is with those. I think this is a sight readable map for the most part. Like we were talking about, it's only AR 9.2. It's not incredibly dense. I think this is largely a mechanics test compared to what you can see in this slot, which does make it a little bit nicer for some players who might not be super, super comfortable on, you know, your extraordinarily awkward hidden one picks, particularly for early stage teams are not super good at hidden. This does leave the other two hiddens as pretty solid bands instead of the hidden one. So, something to look out for there. If you're not very good at hidden, this is probably the pick that your team practice as you ban out something like either the hidden two or hidden three. This hidden two, Conflict by Siromaru and Kurenki. Also, I don't know if Nick has watched the storyboard for this map before, but it is hilarious, so we are leaving it on.
Do I even want to know? Because I've also never heard of this map, but oh. Oh. Oh.
Yeah, the storyboard is very funny.
Well, here's the hidden alt tech map in the hidden pool, that you could say. A lot of elements from both Nomad 4 and Nomad 3 combined into this map.
Also much harder to read than Hidden One, that is for sure. Miss Food, clean your bathroom, move close, go. Thank you, storyboard.
This is unhinged. who did this?
I don't know, the storyboard is so good though, I love it.
Those
are doubles, by the way. Those are double jumps.
Oh, this song is actually just ruined now for me. It's actually just ruined.
Oh, what a great pick. Thanks, Nick. Thank you for that. Yeah.
Now we're going to be getting into Hidden 3, the last hidden map, the AR8 hidden map. Welcome to Down, now a music producer, mostly known for his tournament maps, but yes, he does produce music, as a matter of fact, and this is one of them, named after Lucent, the hidden easy prodigy. Mostly easy. And yeah, this is a reading map.
This is definitely a really simple map for a round of 16. I think that's pretty common in most tournaments, especially country-based ones, where you are not likely to find full teams of reading players who are actually good at your, like, yolk pie style reading maps. I think stuff like this that tests both awkward aim and your ability to be consistent on approach rate 8 with hidden is a far more accessible option, and one that is far more likely to get picked instead of either permabanned or just avoided by most teams. So the direction that tournaments have headed in with low approach rate hidden has really reflected that fact that most teams just won't pick yolks pie style stuff, and so stuff like this instead tends to be far more popular.
Yep,
low approach rate.
Well, in any case, that's the hidden pool, Hard Rock Pool. Starting off with Hard Rock 1, it's your generic everyday aim map. You might have seen this song in other tournaments. I believe one of the other diffs was used as a CS 6.5 pick, but this is not that. This is the aim pick. Welcome to Hard Rock 1. One man circus.
It's Nomad 1, but Hard Rock.
Oh my god.
Whoa.
Revolutionary. No one could have seen this one coming. Yeah, Quarry, well known for being double time, generic aim, MREC 1000 PP man. He does map other things. This is one of those other things.
Whoa. Hard Rock generic aim instead of double time generic aim? Holy shit, we're branching out, man. That's crazy. I don't know. This map is, like, this is very similar to a lot of your generic aim maps, I think. And most people are going to find this pretty, like, pretty tame as a Hard Rock one. I think this is a lot more accessible than last week's pick, which was focused more on, like, pattern aim and stream aim than this one. There is a stream section in this map, but, like, what Hard Rock one doesn't have a stream section in it? It's par for the course.
Yeah. this is the one of, if not the only, stream section, and even then, it's not really a stream section.
Yeah, not like consecutive 5-note bursts.
It's more or less what you would expect from a Kawari map, to be honest. Definitely one of those mappers that have really tried to, I wouldn't really say specialize purposely, but definitely a lot better at mapping comfortable jumps and just general comfort maps than usual. Also, don't miss at that ending.
Yeah, that'd that's a 1-1 really one and not a 1-2 jump at the end.
Be really sad if you missed on the star pattern too, so don't do that.
All right, and now on to an interesting Hard Rock pick, the Hard Rock 2. Love Hard Rock 2.
Yeah, this one also another map that some of you guys might be familiar with, Big Shot from Deltarune. I believe this was ranked last year around the middle of the year. One of the bigger sets, actually. I think this has like 12 difficulties on it. This is Heat Wave's Expert. Yeah, this is the sort of somewhat similar to Hidden 2, the tech alt-oriented pick in the Hard Rock pool. And yeah. Definitely a lot more focused on general aim control. So yes, 5.5. Alongside these types of alt patterns, you'd have to be very comfortable at general aim consistency in order to pick this. Also,
and
don't miss on those sliders. Don't.
Yeah,
don't miss
those
on the sliders.
I'm gonna say there are some very fast reverse sliders in this map that you have to aim. Make sure you aim them.
That's no mod 4 part.
Yeah, basically. They are definitely playable, as we just saw Nanoya hit them. Excuse me, this is Ristol. This is also Ristol. As we just saw Ristol hit them, so just be Ristol and hit the sliders. That simple, guys.
Definitely one of the harder picks in the pool, I'd say, just due to the raw aim consistency you need to be consistent at this, as well as the several different skill sets that you'd need to as well also be comfortable on this.
Yeah,
if you do have those skill sets, it's relatively easy, I'd say.
I can agree with that. I think the Hard Rock alt pick always tends to be a little bit more difficult on average to get higher team scores on, just because of how skill set is in general. Kind of similarly, your precision maps in Hard Rock tend to vary in terms of the average score, depending on really what the skill set is for the map that's being tested. This one, a little bit of everything. You've got your aim consistency, you've got some streaminess in this map, and you've got some kind of tricky patterns, some high spacing here and there, to keep players on their toes throughout this map, which can be really difficult with the aim control required on CS 6.5.
A relatively short pick on this one, though, only a minute 40, the shortest map so far. Not the shortest, however, so keep that in mind. As a matter of fact, a lot of the maps upcoming are actually going to be quite short comparison to the earlier maps that were a lot longer, sort of to offset that, balance out the pool length a bit. So hopefully people won't be mad about having to practice.
Doubling time is a mod for sure.
That's crazy.
But yeah, like I said, a lot of skill sets involved in this one. You've got awkward aim, you've got aim control on some of the stream patterns in this map, you've got cut streams and space triples, you've got slider jumps in this map. There's a lot going on here, and for a CS 6.5 pick, I think that's going to end up making this pretty inaccessible overall. So I think this might be on the harder side for the pool in general.
Yeah, this and Hard Rock 2 are definitely quite a step up in comparison to some of the other maps, but not anything, I'd say, overreaching. Just a lot more technically difficult than you might expect from the Hard Rock pool, but that is going to be the Hard Rock pool, as I say that. Now we're going to be getting into the Double Time pool, and what better way to start off with than VTubers? Wow, I love VTubers.
I can think
Here's the obligatory VTuber map.
Think of a few better ways to start it off than VTubers. They pulled Power by Kanye West as DT1, I think that would be better. If they pulled All of the Lights by Kanye West instead of this as DT1, I think it would be better, but you know what, I guess it works.
Yeah, not really too much to say about this map in general, as it is pretty much what you'd expect from a DT1. Wow, it's aim. And it's almost 10.3, but not quite. 10.2 is the AR on this one. And as Bristol is very easily showing us, very easy to SS, apparently.
Yeah, this is accessible, guys. This is the same dude who hit the sliders on Hard Rock 2. This is easy. But yeah, you can expect approach rate to generally go up over the course of the tournament for Double Time 1. Okay, how it goes. How it goes in Nick's pools most of the time. I'm going to expect BPM to stay around the same. We're already at 255 BPM for DT1. Not really going to expect a lot of changes to that BPM overall.
Yeah, relatively a comfort BPM for most players for Double Time 1. You might see a couple 270s here and there, but by and large, probably going to stay mostly to the 250-260 BPM range for this pick. Wow, Ristol didn't 200 those last two notes. Good job.
That's actually crazy. Guy has like a 60 UR on this map also. That's kind of sick. All right, let's go on to DT2. DT2, as with most DT2s, is a streamy Double Time map. Pretty standard stuff for this DT2 pick. Tsukiyue by Kozato is the pick this time around. 225 BPM, so a little bit slower overall. And AR 8.1? 8.2?
8.2, I believe it is.
Probably.
This is a relatively familiar song. I believe KTGster's set of this has been pulled in. I have lost count of how many tournaments that's actually been in at this point.
Yeah.
This is not that set, for the record. This is a custom map for a Japan tournament, I believe, in quarterfinals. But it's by and large, if you've played this song before, it's by and large what you would expect from this map, just a lot more dense than the KTGster map. Don't get thrown off by these rhythms here, by the way. Those rhythms are somewhat hard to predict, especially when you're sight reading.
you know the song, they're not too bad. But yeah, if you don't know the song and you're trying to just sight read those rhythms, you could definitely be thrown off. Wanna act?
And there's a stream. That's not what you're going to be seeing in the KTG Stir map. As I said, this is a lot more dense. So a lot more fitting for a DT2 pick in general. A lot more stamina consistency for this one in comparison to the KTG Stir set. Still relatively short, 1 minute 40. It's already over. And we're going to be getting into double time 3, the obligatory old map double time slot.
Now this one is an old map with bursts, is how I would describe this. This is an old map that has some bursts in it. This is 270 BPM, by the way. Those are non-trivial bursts, even at, you know, 7 to 9 notes. One thing to note for this map is that this difficulty is on the Semaphore set that is being revived and trying to be ranked. So we are going to use the old Raging Maigo set from back in 2012 or 2011. This difficulty is largely the same between those two sets, so what you see here is pretty much what you get with it.
I am sorry, but I have to interject. I am so sad that you said Raging Maigo.
Instead of?
This is Raging RJ.
What?
Raging RJ is a completely different Russian mapper. Very prolific in the 2012-2013 era. You might have seen a couple of his maps in other tournaments as well.
Okay, I do know Reggie RJ's name. I did not make the connection. Well, good to know. Good to know. But yeah, old map with 270 BPM bursts is the name of the game for this one. A lot of awkward aim, a lot of 270 bursts in the map. That's really all it is.
Also 1 minute long. Fun fact.
Yeah, very short. We were talking about using Reiji's set instead of Semaphore's set, and the map is already over. So,
on to DT4.
On to Double Time 4.
This is a song.
Is it? Is it a song? That's questionable. Is this a song? I don't even know.
I think. Maybe. Hold on, I'll try to give it another go.
Well, you said you wanted Kanye. This is not Kanye, but this is probably
not
the closest
Kanye.
You're gonna get. This is probably the closest you're gonna get. Don't look at the description for this map.
Yeah, this is 150 BPM in double time, but there's 1/8s in this, so those are 300 BPM wherever you see the 1/8s.
DT4 is usually just seen as the, just throw whatever we need in the pool still at this slot. And, yep, that is definitely this map.
Like, alt-tech DT, but also 300 BPM bursts here and there. Kind of weird. Also AR 10.1. Fun fact.
Don't miss on that pattern. That's going to be finalizing the DT pool. Now we're going to be getting into the last three maps before tiebreaker, the free mod pool, starting off with another relatively familiar map, Corsace Open 2021, Hidden 2, this time now in free mod. It's going to be, Rebuild.
This is the flow aim pick. In free mod, map is originally circle size 3.2 and AR 9.3. Adjusted stats with hard rock are listed on stream right now. Also, OD 8.8 for no mod and hidden players, just for your information. A lot of wiggly streams all over the place in this map. I would best describe this. I don't know. Wiggly streams and light finger control in this map. A lot of doubles and quads, which I think has become a lot more expected from players at this type of relatively low BPM. 174, very, very comfortable for a lot of players who tend to go in on these sorts of maps.
Relatively balanced pick for both mods. If you can read hidden streams, this shouldn't be too much of a difficult map for you. And if you can read hard rock streams, well, it's CS 4.2. So you're pretty much just playing an Omod map, but with AR-10. Would not be surprised to see a few hidden hard rocks on this, as a matter of fact. Get into match day, of course. Here's the flow aim section. This is where things get a little wacky. Nothing too out of the ordinary, though. Just your raw flow aim consistency map. Getting into something a bit more interesting now. An older map. Not the oldest map in the pool, granted, but definitely one that you're probably familiar with. An Infinite of Nuclear Fusion, Regau's Diff. I hope I pronounced Regau's name right.
Pretty sure
I always pronounce it... I always pronounce it Regau, but I thought it was Regau now. I don't know. But in any case... This is a wide-angle jump map, mostly focused on aim. You see this quite a bit in Hard Rock pools, actually, but this time it's a free mod map.
Yeah, this is kind of what you expect from, like, relatively old 2011, 2012, 2013 aim consistency maps, actually. Anybody who was around back then is going to find this pretty comfortable, and anybody who wasn't is going to find this pretty uncomfortable, I think. A lot of polygonal aim in this map, a lot of low aim jumps in this map as well that I think are relatively fine for those who have practice on them and relatively uncomfortable for people who don't.
BPM on this one. There are streams in this map, so just be wary of that. But by and large, the majority of the difficulty on this map comes from awkward aim patterns. Like that. Say relatively might see a bit more hard rock on this than say Nomad or Hidden, just for ease of reading, since this is AR9 and OD10 even without hard rock. So yeah. You might see a few people opt to take hard rock. They can offset the slight circle size buff as long as they get the approach rate increase, makes it a bit easier to read.
Yeah, the fact that this is OD10 base makes it, I think, a little bit favored toward hard rock, but the awkward aim doesn't get any easier with hard rock, right? You still have to deal with the increased circle size, so I don't think it's going to be all that bad for hidden players in comparison. Well, maybe for Nomad players. For hidden players, I think it's definitely going to be pretty rough on this map. I think we'll just see the requisite hidden mod for each team on this pick, probably.
That does it for Free Mod 2. Last map of the pool before tiebreaker now is Free Mod 3. Pretty much what you'd expect from Free Mod 3. It's a CS5 AR8 map. Go! Nightcore mix. Bike.
this is the Sunny Seas Expert on an AJT map set. It is pretty much what you would expect from Sunny Sea, actually. A lot of 1-1 jumps in this map. Also, yeah, those repeat sliders on Hard Rock are ones that you have to follow. Good luck with that, I suppose. If Shadoos can hit them, so can you.
They are in the first 10 seconds of the map, so even if you do slider break on them with Hard Rock, probably not going to matter too much.
Yeah, and then the rest of the map is like this.
Yeah, just don't have your nerves destroy you, and you should be fine. Yeah, pretty, I'd say, heavily influenced by Jero and those types of maps you'd see. Andrea, like, all that sort of stuff. Very heavy symmetry usage. Very grid snappy sort of feel to this map.
That is entirely the feel that Sunny Sea goes for. Is of the old symmetrical grid snap, entirely pattern based types of maps that also focus on these types of 1-1 jumps. This particular type of patterning is something that he has been very outspoken about missing from modern maps. So, something that he intentionally tries to put into his mapping where possible.
So shout out to Shadoo still holding the SS, almost breaking it on the slider there.
You did that on purpose, didn't you? I know you did.
I mean, that wasn't even timed properly. Like, that wasn't... That was, like, a solid 30 seconds after I said that. I wouldn't say that's anywhere close to being cursed or anything.
Yeah, I've heard these excuses before. I've heard this line before, all right? I know your tricks.
Yeah, my bad.
I know every trick in the book, all right? I know this guy. I know what he's doing. All right.
My bad, all right.
All right, let's get on to the tiebreaker. Last map of the round of 16. Well, it is 21st by Lulikma and Loctech. I probably didn't pronounce those right, but let's get into it. Last Ristol replay of the pool also.
This was a Clover Cup tiebreaker. I believe Clover Cup had several tiebreakers. This was, I think, the second tiebreaker for the quarterfinals pool. We're just using it as the tiebreaker in round of 16 here.
That is like almost Gorshid-esque, I feel. Like Grummed inspired type of mapping. Or Grummed adjacent, I don't know. A lot of consecutive bursts were pretty close to consecutive bursts in this map, punctuated by a lot of inconsistency in between or slider aim and finger control. Typically one of those two. And that's the majority of the patterning in this map. Very repetitive song, very repetitive types of patterning that lend themselves well to very slight changes over the course of the map.
I'm gonna be honest, I'm actually getting more DJ Sharpnel vibes than Gorshid vibes from this.
I can see it. I can see both, but I can see DJ Sharpnel.
General consistency tiebreaker test. What you would expect from a tiebreaker. You got 200 BPM bursts, some streams, some tech oriented sections like what we just saw over there. Lots of aim. Hey, here's another tech section.
stream section. Into probably aim after this.
Yeah, you can see sort of how this just combines pretty much every skill set aside from, like, Nomad 3. You have your Nomad 4, you got your Nomad 5, if the BBM was any higher. You got your Nomad 2 section here. Those are some fast repeat sliders, actually. I don't know if anyone's going to go Hard Rock on this. Not like you would, since it's a tiebreaker, but...
Yeah, no, I don't expect any Hard Rocks on the tiebreaker most of the time. Regardless of those repeat sliders, but yeah, those are... Would not want to play with this with Hard Rock.
I love Gabber.
Yeah, that's definitely a gore shit part.
And here's your aim part. Well, kind of aim, but...
I just kind of aim everywhere in this map. We do play Osu, so... No.
No!
Aim game. Aim game. I don't think there's, like, a dedicated jump section to this map, but they are kind of everywhere. In effect, so you find yourself... The map catches you lacking at any point. They'll page you.
Wacky doubles, actually.
There's a little bit of fingering all throughout this map, either in the doubles or in the gore shit parts, the main parts where it has finger control. That is going to do it for the map pool showcase as well. You can probably find the map pool. Yes, you can find the map pool on the sheet right now. It is released for your practice purposes. If you have, if you have any complaints, put them in map pool feedback, and they may or may not be listened to, depending on the map pooler's moods on that day. Schedules are probably out. Schedules are already out on the main sheet. Go take a look. Look at the schedules. Qualifier results and all that are also on the sheet. And that is it for us. Thanks everybody for watching. We'll see you all next weekend for our first batch of matches.
See you guys then.